there are over 2 billion Christians all over the world. Why? What does it mean? What's it all about? Emmanuel is going to be taking a journey through what it means to be Christian. And you are invited. Only at Emmanuel UMC.
Today we'll be talking about the church. And so we'll be beginning with our first scripture from the book of Matthew. If you'd like to follow along, it's on the screen or it's located in your pew Bibles, Matthew 18, 20. It's a long one, so hold on. For where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. When I decided what we were going to talk about, when we talked about church, I first thought, let's talk about the book of Acts through today, because there's a lot that's changed, a lot of transitions. We're actually, this year is the 500 year anniversary of the Reformation, and we were going to talk about what that means. But to me, that was a little bit too second step. And so we had to boil it down even further than that. Because I was reminded of a time I had met a woman, my very first church, who had just started coming. And I was so excited to see a new face. And I said, welcome, thank you for coming. What is it that brought you to our church? And she started telling me about the place she used to worship. She kept calling it that. The place I used to worship. She didn't call it a church. She said, well, it was in a movie theater. And we sat in the theater, and all the people around me, they had popcorn. And I said, that is not, she said to me, that is not church. Church isn't popcorn. Church isn't folding auditorium seats. I thought about it, and I said, well, we're so glad that you're here. I hope that our building and our people welcome you and that you can find a home here at St. Peter. But it stuck with me, this idea that she had decided what church was not and that she had so sorely missed the point. So I decided today we were going to talk about church from the beginning, the most simple piece. And so that's why we had such a simple piece of scripture, where two or more are gathered. Now, what we learn from this verse on what church is, first part is two or more. That implies a group. Church is not a singular activity. I'm not church myself. I'm just a person. So when we look at what church must be, it must be a community of people. Now, communities can be large and communities can be small. I had the experience of worshiping in a sanctuary this weekend that their fire marshal sign that said what their occupancy was just over 2,700 people for their sanctuary, and they have to have three or four services to make sure everybody can have their turn in the sanctuary because they worship thousands of people. But I also met a pastor there that started their church with 17 people and have grown it. But their church was a church from day one because there was two or more people in community. And the other half of the statement, where two or more gathered, that's where God is. And we learn that in that community, God is a participant. So this is in communion with God. That no matter how hard we try, we cannot be church unless God is involved. If we do, we're just a group of people. Might be a large group of people. We might be a passionate group of people. But if it's not about God and God isn't a part of it, we're not a church. Now, there's some things in this passage that are not mentioned that I think are equally important. There's no mention of a building. know, sometimes we get wrapped up. I know you guys have had this conversation before here at the church. The church is people. The church is not a building. Sometimes we even think that church has to be a building or a specific type of building. That there are people that think that church belongs to what they think church should be. This lovely old lady who came to be a part of St. Peter, I believe is still there, because she believed that you needed pews and a disturbing lack of popcorn to be a church. But what we see in the Bible is that Jesus, giving his first and most famous Sermon on the Mount, was on a hillside. There was times that he would be in a boat preaching to the shore because there was just too many people. He was outside. Even before Jesus, back in the Old Testament times, we had a tabernacle, which is just a tent. It's a fancy tent, but it's a tent. Just kind of that half outdoors, half indoors, right? You had to walk through the sand to get there. You know, you could hear the outside through the fabric that was draped. And then after Jesus, in the book of Acts, and from there, when we talk about first century Christians, they met in the holy temples, which were these giant, humongous, ornate buildings, and they were wonderful. But they also met in homes. In fact, almost all of the early Christian churches met in homes, in living rooms. I don't know that they were called that at the time. I have a professor, I should ask about that. But he actually goes out to archaeological digs to identify things. He's been to four of them in the Middle East, all different places. But he says, they call me in to identify a first or second century church. And I said, well, why do they do that? Can't they tell? I mean, what's unique about that? And he said, well, it's difficult because it's just a home. It's hard to tell a home from a church in the first century churches. So what we learn from this is our building, our bricks and mortar, is not what makes us a church. That Jesus held services on the hilltops and on the lake shores. We have that in-between space of inside and outside of a tent, which I'm not much of a camper, so that doesn't appeal to me to have church in a tent, but you can do it. And then homes or temples. Church is not about the building. What we also don't see here is a definition of personnel. It doesn't say where two of us are gathered and one of them is ordained, or two of us have gathered and one of them is the leader. One of them has gone to seminary. One of them calls themselves pastor. One of them has been formally educated. Even in the time immediately after Jesus, I should say especially in the time immediately after Jesus, Jesus did a great job building a church. He had quite the following. He had fellowship events of thousands of people. When we talked last week about the Holy Spirit and the days of Pentecost, where like these fishermen, these wildly unqualified people, with the help of the Holy Spirit, would stumble out into the streets and convert 2,000 people. That would give sermons, but they weren't sermons. They were scripture. They were reciting scripture. They were telling people about Jesus and how Jesus has come to fulfill the prophecies. And that was church. Church isn't about me as pastor. It's not about lay leaders. It's not about speakers. It's not about podiums. It's about God. That's the only authority that we see in this first example of church. Sometimes we let that clog us, slow us down. Who's in charge? We got to form a committee. Let's take a vote. We want to make sure everybody's happy. But when it comes down to church, it's community, together with God. That's its most fundamental definition, But we can't leave it there. There are two facets that are equally important, two focuses that the church must have to still be a church outside of having God involved. The first is an inward focus, the inward focus of discipleship, of fellowship, of that community. This is important. This is where we learn. This is things like ministries like Bible study, like choir, like Sunday school, like getting together before a parade and goofing off before we give out root beer floats. The inward focus. It's what brings us to a place to challenge ourselves to become better as Christians, to know more about God, to bring the message to outside of the church, to train us up, to make us disciples. But equally important is that outward focus. That's the other side of the coin. This is evangelism, outreach, and mission. These are ministries like mission trips, Light Up Jefferson, which is just a few weeks away, sharing our faith stories, giving away backpacks. This is where we take God into the community. Not that God's not already there, but we're partnering. We're not already there. God's bringing us into the community is what I should say. And you need both to be balanced. If you have only the inward focus, as some churches do, where all we do as a church is look at ourselves and how we can serve ourselves. And that sounds worse than it is. There's great intentions. This is things like the churches that focus very heavily on Bible study and things like Financial Peace University and education in the congregation to make the congregation better, which is a good thing. But if that's all we're doing, we neglect the part of the Great Commission that we talked about several weeks ago. Go. Go. Go is an action. You have to exit. You have to be somewhere that you're not right now to go. I can't say, go stay in that pew, unless you're not in the pew, which is, you know, go. But if we are too outwardly focused, which there are churches that are this way, they neglect what follows the go and make disciples. If all we did all day long as a church were to bring people into this building and then go out and find more people. So you want to be a Christian? And they say, probably. And you just leave them here? And we don't teach them what Jesus did for them. We don't show them what it means to be a disciple. We don't come alongside them and bring them into us becoming better. Well, that's not a church either. I'm not even sure what that is. Some churches do this. They have incredible numbers of new members coming in the door every single day. And when they get here, they learn how to go out and make more Christians, not really even knowing what a Christian is themselves. Because all they got was a sales pitch. And then they got taught the pitch and sent back out the door. So we need both. You need to be inward and outwardly focused. A group of people in communion with God. And when we talk about these two focuses, this I think is important, is these two focuses sometimes we make it most of the way there, but not quite. When we talk about the inward focus, our inward focus needs to meet the needs of everyone, help them to grow, no matter where they're beginning. Discipleship isn't just for Christians who have been Christians their whole lives or people who have been here more than a few weeks. Say, well, I was back when Pastor such and such was here, so there's no levels in church. So our inward focus needs to be communal. It needs to be all of us. We're all in this together. And our outward focus, if we are not a church that welcomes and ministers to everyone, then and we're not actually welcoming or ministering. My favorite thing to say about Emmanuel is that I think that we are as friendly as we think we are. And it usually gets a chuckle and then a thoughtful stare. Because there's plenty of churches that think they're as welcoming and ministering. But it's not about everyone. It's about the people that seem a lot like us. And that's a scary thing to think of for a church. But that got me thinking about Emmanuel. Emmanuel became Emmanuel United Methodist Church in 1968. This is when the EUB, or the Evangelical United Brethren, merged with the Methodist Church. We took the United from right in the middle there and stuck it in with our Methodist, and we became something new. And that itself is not earth-shattering. There are hundreds of denominations, splitting and fusing constantly. But for us, it's kind of important. We're talking about. Now, looking past the numbers, I only have some data, but based on that, we had an attendance peak in the year 1982, where the conference tells me we were worshiping 394. We had 394 worshiping members. Now, you don't have to look around and count. There are not 394 people here today. Actually, I haven't seen the sign in, but I'm going to guess. And that's okay. Somewhere along the line, we were taught, probably by an English teacher, that stories have this peak, this climax, this place that we build to, and then everything resolves at the end, and then it's over. The good news is, real life isn't that way. The stories of people don't have one climax, one peak. The stories of churches are the same way. When we talk about being part of a new chapter here at Emmanuel United Methodist Church, a new time, a new energy, a new mission. And I would challenge us to say our mission is not new. I think maybe we were just not moving in that direction for a time. Our mission is to be a church, to be a group of people in community with each other and with God, to be inward in that community to make ourselves and each other better, and to be outwardly focused to bringing other people into that community. And that community is not limited to our church, to our pews, to our events, but that community is the kingdom of God. It's the body of Christ. So the most important thing that you can take from this sermon today, you can write this down if you'd like, that God is not done writing our story. We are the church. We are Emmanuel United Methodist Church. We serve the community. We are in communion with God. We are geared towards discipleship and outreach. And if we aren't yet, you can bet your bottom dollar we will be. Geared towards discipleship and outreach. Because that is our mission, that is our call, and that is where our future lies. As the body of Christ, we will be all of those things and more. Because when we have faith in Jesus, we are faithful to Jesus. And when we desire to be his body in the world, amazing things happen. As we depart from this building today, remember that we are at the beginning of something amazing. Our story is not yet finished being written by God. How that story goes with this church, that's up to us. So let's make it a good one.